praise. Father, we give you glory. Father, we give you adoration. Father, we bow before you. Father, we say you are the Most High God, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Just worship the King of Kings. Father, we give you praise. Ancient of Days, we worship you. Ancient of Days, as old as you are, as old as you are, you will never change. Ancient of Days, as old as you are, as old as you are, you will never change. Ancient of Days, ancient of Days, as old as you are, as old as you are, older than the oldest, you will never change. You are higher than the highest. Ancient of Days, as old as you are, as old as you are, Ancient of Days, we are grateful because you are higher than the highest, you are older than the oldest, you are ageless, you are limitless, you are mighty, you are the King of Kings, you are the Lord over lords, you are the Lord over presidents, you are the Lord over princes, you are the Lord over nations, you are the Lord over tribes, you are the Lord over tongues. You are the reason for this worship this morning. And to you we package our praise. And to you we package our thanksgiving. And to you we package our honor. And to you we package our adoration. Lord, receive it from us. Lord, receive it from us. Lord, receive it from us. The Bible says the Lord reigneth, let the earth tremble. Lord, the Bible says that at the mention of the name of Jesus, all knees will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. So we pray today that unction and grace and the flow in the Spirit will be given to me as I teach and preach and heal. Let it not be my words, Lord. Let it be your words, written and spoken and prophesied to the hearts of the hearers. Give us time in the Holy Ghost to do exactly what you want us to do. And at the end of it all, those of us in the service this morning, those listening online, and those who will be watching the YouTube in any part of the world, give us an unforgettable encounter. Thank you, faithful Father. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. And the living church will say a louder amen.
Amen.
Thank you very much. Choir, that was a wonderful one. Can we just clap to the Lord and give glory to God? That was a wonderful, wonderful, soul-lifting song. Even if that is the only reason why we've come to service this morning, I've been blessed. I'm telling you, it ministered to my spirit. I receive a word. I'll be teaching some strange subject from the scripture this month of September. Subject like what I'm talking about today. Perhaps you might not have had anybody preach it before. Perhaps you have had somebody preach it before. And I'll also be preaching about a subject in 2 Sundays' time called painkillers. Painkillers. Do you know there are painkillers stronger than Panadol in the Bible? Do you know there are painkillers stronger than paracetamol in the Bible? You don't want to wait. Join me in 2 weeks' time. One mighty revelation the Lord gave me about 2 weeks ago. This morning, I'm talking about the paradox of our faith. So like I said, I don't know, maybe you have had somebody preach it before, but I know it's a very strange subject in the scripture. It's a very strange subject that people don't even think about. But this is an encounter when I gave my heart to Jesus Christ that the Lord gave me. And I want to share it with you. Briefly, don't forget that we are in the service in the presence of the Lord. And there are three categories of people in every service. Those who hear the word but do not remember the word after. Those who hear the word and remember it but do not use it. And so they are without a testimony. The third category of the people is this. And I know you are one of such. Those who hear the word, they remember it and use it. So they produce 30% testimony, 60% testimony, and 100-fold testimony. Clap your hands and celebrate God. Yes, say, I am in the service this morning. Praise the name of the Lord. You are welcome, Chantel and Clint. Please, can you just greet somebody and say you are welcome to service this morning? And I know you are here to have a testimony after this encounter. And I know you are here to have an encounter after the word. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now don't forget also that the faintest ink is sharper than the human brain. Hallelujah. I said the faintest ink is sharper than the human brain. So when you are in the service, learn to jot things down. If you cannot jot down, please get your pad and type and refer to it later. Praise the name of the Lord. Sometimes we have encounters with the Lord, even from things that the preacher has not spoken, and you want to go and refer to it so that you can use it as your victory code. Praise the name of the Lord. Remain focused and expectant all through the world. Expectations remain the raw material for miracle. Your attitude in the service is contagious. So you want to keep it in the Holy Ghost and within the scriptural bound. You may be acting for demons or you may be acting for angels. And lastly, I love this one. One word from God is all you need in this service for a lifelong testimony and a turnaround. Praise the name of the Lord. In 2012, I had an unusual opportunity, and it presents to us exactly what I'm talking about today. That was the year I can say my ministry took an international dimension. And I had an invitation to the U.S. and I preached in 5 states in different churches. And I witnessed a lot of people delivered, a lot of people healed. I was so happy and I was blessed. I was returning back to Nigeria, to my local base. I had to travel through Casablanca. I flew through from New York to Casablanca, and then I was preparing to fly from Casablanca to Lagos. But I had like almost half a day layover. So the Air Maroc, which I took, I remember very vividly, were so gracious. So they decided to put me in one of their hotels in Casablanca. Here was I've had one of the most exciting moments of my ministry in life. And here was I was blessed. And I fell on top of the world. But at the same time, my heart is full of grace. So as they finished the proceedings and gave me the key, I was even sleepy because before I went to the flight, I think I preached in two or three churches. I flew from Lexington to New York to preach in another church and all that. So I just managed to get into the airport and I was sleepy. Don't forget what I'm about to say. I thought 2012 was the best year of my life. I can remember, I think I left New York January 6th of 2013. Because I traveled for a month. I've been in the U.S. for almost a month preaching and teaching like that. And I thought, whoa, this 2012 was the best of my years. And as I was stepping into the hotel, I don't have such encounters often, but I had an audible voice. And that voice said, if you continue in my grace this year, your cup will be full and overflowing. I didn't understand what God meant. So I didn't assume I understand what he meant. And I began to pray. In the midst of my prayers, and in the midst of my researching into what God meant by saying, if you continue in my grace, it showed me James chapter 4, verse 6. He giveth more grace unto the humble. He says, God receives the proud, but gives more grace unto the humble. And I realized for the first time in the midst of my researching, for what God, what do you mean by grace? That he was talking about humility. I remember in that very year, I kept on praying. And one day I was preaching to people, and God gave me a word of knowledge. He said, I should tell, I just see myself prophesying to myself, but the people would think I'm prophesying. And I said to people, I said, I am not the first person to travel abroad, and I wouldn't be the last person to travel. And that was the key for me. A lot of us, when we have a blessing, especially blessings that looks unique, especially for us Africans, or from any part of the world, blessings of moving from your country to a country like this, you feel above the board. You feel nobody can correct you. You feel nobody can talk to you. You feel even God cannot talk to me. You feel God's servant cannot correct me. You feel above yourself. Can I tell you, there is greater breakthrough than transportation, either through the land or the sea or the air, from one location to the other. So that year, to the glory of God, I realized God was speaking to me about humility. And even though I prayed for grace to walk in humility, I consciously walked in humility. 2013 was double for me. I don't want to share the testimony. The blessing that came to my life as a result of choosing to walk in humility in 2013 was awesome. God made the blessing to even rub off on my wife. Praise the name of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
That's why this morning I'm speaking to you on the paradox of our faith. What is paradox? What is paradox? Paradox is a seemingly absurd or contradictory statement. A statement that looks contradictory. Or proposition which, when investigated or researched into, will prove to be well-founded or true. What is paradox? Paradox, summarily, means logically contradictory but true. Did you hear me, church? Logically contradictory but true. Look at Mark chapter 8, verse 35. And look at this very statement of Jesus that is contradictory but true. Sometimes we don't give thought to them, but they look like twisty. Mark, can you read it on the screen if you find it? Let's read it together, church, quickly.
For whosoever will save his life shall lose it.
Mark chapter 8, verse 35. Read it again. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel, the same shall save it. Jesus preached this word. And it's in print. It's in many hearts. It's in many spirits. But the world has never lived this way. You know that the world chooses to live this way. You save your life, you get saved. It's not you lose your life, you get saved. Paradox. Am I right? You go to a party. And they said, and you have been hungry. And everyone is rushing for the food. Your natural instinct tells you, go for the food. But the Spirit says, let others have the food and you will have the food. Will you believe that? Lose the food and then the food will be yours. Does that make sense? Paradox of our faith. And all through the scriptures, from Genesis to Revelation, we have instances of statement and people who practiced what looks paradoxical, and it was the key to their testimony. Everybody say the paradox of our faith.
Paradox.
So what Jesus Christ says here does not look sensible. What Jesus Christ says here is what we are supposed to be doing, but this is not what the whole world is doing. Praise the name of the Lord. Let's look at it. Number two, when we say our faith, what does that mean? Our faith in this sense connotes our belief for worship, not our trust in God. So we are not talking about, so somebody will call our faith in this sense religion. So the paradox of our religion. But you know that we are not religious. Somebody looked at me this week and he says, "You look religious." I said, "I'm not religious." I wanted to confuse him because I want to use the opportunity to preach to him. He said, "I'm not religious." He said, "But you go to church." "Yeah, I go to church a lot, but I'm not religious." Of course I'm not religious. Christianity is not religion. Christianity is the kingdom of heaven. Come to the kingdom of heart. So that Jesus will be Lord of the kings of our heart. Clap your hands and celebrate. I still wait for opportunity to preach to him. I'm not religious. So we call it religion, but it is a way of life in God's kingdom among men on earth. Let's look at the paradox of our faith. I'm going to be presenting it to you from scriptures. Hallelujah. Are you ready for it? Are you as excited as I'm excited? The Bible teaches that the way up is down. Are you with me? The way down. You got it now. The way up is where?
Down.
If you want to go up, there is no shortcut to going up. I have a mentor who used to tell me, "Charles, you cannot climb up except on the shoulder of another person. You need somebody's shoulder to climb up." In your career, find out you need somebody who will be pushing you in that office. You may not give him money. You may not give him anything. God will just make him to favor you. Even in ministry, you need a shoulder of somebody to lift you up. Jesus teaches the way up is down. Let's look at Elisha and Elijah. You know, the Bible told us that eventually, at the end of the picture, Elisha had more anointing than Elijah. Even though Elijah looks as his father in the faith. Hallelujah. What did Elisha do to become better than his father in the faith? 2 Kings chapter 3, verse 13. The way up. Read it for me from the screen if you find it. The way up is what?
And Elisha said unto the people.
Read it, don't worry. Go on.
And Elisha said,
2 Kings chapter 3, verse 11. 2 Kings chapter 3, verse 11. Let's go. And Elisha said, "As the Lord of hosts liveth, before whom I stand."
But Jehoshaphat said,
2 Kings. There's a mix up. Sorry. 2 Kings chapter 3, verse 11. But Jehoshaphat said, "Is there not here a prophet of the Lord?" Let's read. "That we may inquire of the Lord by him." I know what I'm saying. "And one of the king of Israel's servants answered and said, Here is Elisha, the son of Shaphat, which pour water on the hands of Elijah." Come on, say the way up.
The way up
is down. I can't imagine somebody with a double portion of the anointing of God eventually starting with what? Elijah finished eating. "Elisha, bring water for me. I want to wash my hand." I've met people in churches. I've been a pastor for a long time. Who boast and say they cannot serve their pastor. But that's not true. That's not scriptural. Because you cannot see God. If you cannot serve God through somebody you believe God is in, there is no way that you can serve God the way you want to serve. Can you imagine? As anointed as he eventually became, he started by bringing water to wash his master's hand. Humility. To the extent that by the time Elijah left, the only thing that people can remember about him was that he was one man that used to follow Elijah around. And each time Elijah finished eating, he washes his hand for him. Hallelujah. Eventually, he became so stupid that his master told him in 2 Kings chapter 2, he said, "Today, I'm finally departing from you. And as I'm departing from you, please can you just ask me what you want me to do for you?" There were at least 4 conversational hindrances that could make Elisha not have the double portion. And 3 locational hindrances. I studied that scripture in 2 Kings chapter 2. And he kept on following him about. From Bethel, he says, "I'm going to Bethel." And he says, "I will follow you." He got to Bethel. The sons of the prophet said, "You know today your pastor is going to be, all of you hold your peace." He said, I'm going to Jericho. He followed him to Jericho. He said, "I'm going to Jordan." He followed him to Jordan. When he got to Jordan, he saw him, took his mantle, and smote the waters, and the water parted into the sea. Well, he said, "Well, you said you want to get a double portion of my anointing. There is one condition. Focus in humility. Focus in humility." He said, "If you see me when I'm taking up, then you will get it." Who is your Elijah? See, I may not be your Elijah, but who is your Elijah? Are you looking at him? When he is departed from this world, can you get a double portion of what he carries? Said, "If you see me when I'm taking off, then the double portion will become yours." And the Bible says, I love that story. And theologian says it's an exact image of the rapture. 3 images of the rapture are prepared, shown us in scripture. Enoch, the way Enoch was taken away, and the way Elijah was taken away, and the way Jesus was taken away. And we believe the 4th one will be us. Elisha could only manage 4 wars. "My father, my father, the chariots of Israel and his horse rider thereof." And in a flash, Elijah was taken away, and he saw him, but he got it, he never knew, until he took his mantle, and then he discovered the way up. It's not up. It's not from up. It's down. Number 2, the way to be wise is to become flesh. I don't know, maybe you have read that in the scriptures. 1 Corinthians chapter 20, chapter 1, our text, says that the way to be wise, do you know that the Bible even says that, shut your mouth, keep quiet, when you are in the front of a stupid person, when you don't perceive understanding in what he's saying. Do you know sometimes wise men's silence does not mean that they are stupid. Do you know some people will insult you? Some people will intentionally, attack you with their words. And somehow, if you are not sensitive, the Holy Spirit will say, "Don't say anything." Don't you know that sometimes it is your silence that will lead to your victory? He says, the way to be wise is to become what? Foolish. Let's look at that scripture. And let's speak to it. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. I know that God is going to use this to bless you. And I still pray that he will use it to bless you. Verse 27. Are you with me? Read it with me, John. But God has chosen the foolish things of this world to confound the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of this world to confound the things that are mighty. See, it still amazes me till today. The overseer of this church, his life still amazes me. See, I like to be frank. And can I tell you one frank thing? When I was in school, and you are my lecturer, and you are too slow, I won't enjoy your lecture. You believe me? I like fast lecturers. Because I don't understand why you will say something 3 times when I already have grabbed it. So when I became a Christian, slow preachers, I don't enjoy them. But there are eloquent preachers in my country. One of them is a lawyer. If he prays alone, you want to listen to him. There are so many eloquent preachers in my country. I'm telling you. Some of these people can tell you. But none of them is as respected as the slowest of them in speech.
Do you understand? None of them has a national impact, an international impact, even like him. He's the one that God used to gather the largest human gathering on earth. Yes, when he's preaching, you can sleep off. He didn't choose the orators. He didn't choose the eloquent ones. You think God does not know what he's doing? Hallelujah.
Amen.
The ways to be wise. And the things of the world, I wish you'd be blessed by that. And the things of the world, and the things which are despised, that are God chosen, yea, things which are not, to bring to naught things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. Yes. Hallelujah. We got the message. The way to be wise is to become what? Number three, the way to honor is not campaigning for it. The way to honor is not advertising for it. The way to honor is not making a demand. Don't you know who I am? The day you say, don't you know who I am? It's a reflection of that you are nothing. Hallelujah. The way to honor, according to the scripture, is humility. Proverbs chapter 15, verse 33. Proverbs 15, verse 33. Read it with me. Just read it. Read it if it's on the screen. The fear of the Lord is the what? Read it, read it, read it, read it, read it. The fear of the Lord is what?
Is the instruction of wisdom.
And before what?
Honor.
And before what?
Honor.
And before what?
Honor.
Is what?
Humility.
The way to honor is humility. Look at Luke chapter 4, verse 8. The very words of Jesus. The way to honor is humility. Hallelujah. Look at verse 8. In verse 8, he says, and Jesus answered and said, Luke chapter 14, sorry. Luke 14. Are you there? Okay, verse 8. When thou art bidden of any man to a wedding, sit not down in the highest room. This is Jesus' teaching. Let a more honorable man than thou be bidden of him, and if thou bid thee, and him come say to thee, give this man space. And thou began with shame to take the lowest room. But when thou art bidden, go and sit down in the lowest room, that when he had bade thee cometh, he may say unto thee, friend, go up higher, and thou shalt have worship in the presence of him that sits. For whosoever exalted himself shall be what? And whosoever what? Humbled himself shall be honored. The way to honor is what? Humility. Number four, quickly. The way to get is not grab. The way to get is not to grab. The way to get is to give. No. Grab it, grab it, grab it. No, that's not the way. The way to get. As a matter of fact, when you are in need, when you are in lack, when you notice a season of need and lack in your life, understand that it is the season to start giving. Because life responds to what? Seed. Harvest responds to what? Seeds. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Look at Luke chapter 6, verse 38. It says, give, and it shall be given back unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaking together, and running over, shall men give unto your bosom. Say, with the same measure that you what? Measure to people. The measure of your outflow is the measure of your what? Inflow. But he says, no, I will give you good measure, pressed down, shaking together, and running over. Hallelujah. Proverbs chapter 11, verse 28. Proverbs chapter 11, verse 28. The way to get is not to grab. Proverbs chapter 11 verse 28. These things are in the scripture, and you know, I really want us to actually feel the power of the scriptures. Maybe I should be reading it from the screen. Proverbs 11:28. Are you there? He says, he that trusted in his riches shall fall, but the righteous shall flourish as a branch. Now go to verse 24. It says, there is that scattereth and yet increaseth. And there is that withholdeth more than his meat, but he tendeth to what? Poverty. The liberal soul shall be made fat. And he that watered shall be watered also himself.
Amen.
And he that withholdeth corn, the people shall curse him, but the blessing shall be upon the head of him that selleth it. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Some of us, when we collect our stipends, can I take his stipends compared to the blessings, to the riches of heaven? When you collect your weekly stipends or bi-weekly stipends, you keep looking at it. As you are looking at it, you are thinking. As you are looking at it, you are calculating. How can I give God 10%? How can I give God 10%? Of how much? 1,000? Of how much? 500? Of how much? 1,005. You are in trouble if you hand 2,000 per week. Because they will soon tax that. Tax you. Are you in the news? I'm just joking anyway. And you keep looking at it. You keep looking at it and calculating. Praise the name of the Lord. Thinking that the way to get is to grab more of what belongs to God. Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house, says the Lord. And prove me now herewith, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there be no room enough to receive. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and see the confirmation of what I'm talking about. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, quickly. Maybe we should do this together. Let me move a little bit. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Chapter 9, sorry. Verse 1. Let's start from verse 1. Read.
And
for as touching the ministering to the saints, it is superfluous for me to write to you. For I know the forwardness of your mind, for which I boast of you to them of Macedonia, that Achaia was ready a year ago, and your zeal hath provoked very many. Yet have I sent the brethren, lest our boasting of you should be in vain in this behalf, that as I said, ye may be ready. Lest happily if they of Macedonia come with me and find you unprepared, that we say, should we be ashamed in the same confident boasting? Let's go on. Therefore, I thought it necessary to exhort you. It was an exhortation that they will go before you and make up beforehand your bounty. They were givers. Whereof ye had noticed before that the same might be ready as a matter of bounty, as not as a matter of covetousness. That Paul is saying, I'm not covetous of your bounty. And he now says, but this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap sparingly. Don't worry about it. Standard of the scripture. It's not Pastor Charles' work. And he which soweth bountifully shall reap what? Bountifully. Let's go. Every man, according as he purposed in his heart, so let him give, not grudge. I feel like telling somebody, you are a blessed person. God is faithful and blessing you. Do you know what will happen if you are faithful to tithing and the kind of blessing you'll be talking about? Let him give, not grudgingly, and this is where I stop, not grudgingly, or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. Come on, say after me, say the way to get.
is not to grab,
but to give. Let's look at the man that grabbed in scripture. I'm not done yet. Genesis chapter 13 from verse 2, thereabout. Let's look at this prototype, and you know the story very well. And Abraham was very rich in cattle, silver, and in gold. And he went and his journey from the south, even to Bethel, unto the place where his tent had been at the beginning, between Bethel and Ai. Let's go. And unto the place of the altar which he had made, there the first, and there Abraham called on the name of the Lord. Verse 5. And Lot also which went with him had flocks and herds and tents. Here is another. Here are two blessed people. And then something happened. And the land was not able to bear them, that they might dwell together, for their substance was great, so that they could not dwell together. And something happened for that still. And there was a strife between the hard men of Abraham's cattle and the hard men of Lot's cattle. And the Canaanite and the Perizzite dwelt them in the land. Verse what? 8. And Abraham said unto Lot, may the spirit of Abraham rest upon you. May the attitude of Abraham rest upon you. With your blood brothers. With your blood sisters. It is easy to be fighting with your blood brothers, fighting with your blood sisters. About who should what? Submit. See, and he says, I pray thee between me and thee, and between thy hard men and thy hard men, for we prepared them. Look at it. Is not the whole land before thee? Separate thyself, I pray thee, from me. If thou wilt take the left hand, then I will go to the right. If thou wilt depart to the right hand, then I will go to the left. Sorry, church. Who is the uncle? Who is the nephew? I think Lot is the uncle. Am I right? In every culture, who should take first? Who should make the first choice? I think it's the uncle, not the nephew. Here is the uncle with a spirit of giving or grabbing. And he pushed his nephew into destruction. Not because of him, because of his own ability. I want to say, he didn't push him. He escaped destruction. And he says, make a choice. I thought the humble Lord should have said, my uncle, why should I choose first? You made me what I am. You brought me out, and I was penniless. I was not as rich as this. You made the first choice. No, Lord said. Now my uncle knows that we are becoming post-millionaires, and I'm going to show him now. So he looked, and Lord lifted up his eye. Each time you see somebody lifting up his eyes in scripture, he's in danger. It's a sign of pride. He lifted up his eyes, and behold all the plain of Jordan. He chose by sight, and he chose to his own destruction. He lost everything and lost his family as well. You know the end of the story. The way to get is not to grab. The way to life, number 5, quickly. We're so close. The way to life is what? Death. Everybody say the way to life is death. That's why Jesus Christ says, if you lose your life, you will save it. And if you save your life, you will lose it. For what shall it profit a man if he gains the whole world or lose his own soul? The way to greatness, I'm rounding up, is not to be served, but to serve. The way to greatness is to be a servant. Great leaders are loyal, excellent followers. If you are not a good follower, you cannot be a good leader. Write it down. If you are not a good follower, if you are too arrogant and proud to follow anybody, there is no way that people will follow you in life. Those are hard sayings, but they are truth. Look at Mark chapter 9 quickly, verse 33. Mark chapter 9, verse 33. I'm rounding up. Mark chapter 9, verse 33. Are you there? The paradox of our faith. He says in verse 33, I read, and he came to Capernaum, and being in the house, he asked them, what is it that ye dispute among yourselves by the way? But they held their peace, for by the way they had disputed among themselves, who should be the greatest? Hallelujah. You know, thank God, we are not yet big, but I belong to a big church in the past. I pastored a church larger than this. Do you know among deacons they can be fighting who can preach more? I've managed 4 deacons in a fairly average church. And I know what I'm talking about. We are not yet there, but we'll get there. Before we get there, let's start telling ourselves. It can happen. It's not the flesh. It happens in every place. Even in Holiness Church, I've had people say, we're having a retreat this year, and they didn't give me any message to preach. So the disciples too were saying, who should be the greatest? But they held their peace. They dare not, as those pastors and deacons dare not show it to Jesus today. They dare not show their thought to Jesus today. I'm better than that deacon. Why should he be the one preaching? You know, I can say some sensitive things I saw a vision in those days that I used to travel out of my church. And I knew the person that would take over. So, and I saw the fire in him. So, most of those times, when I go like that, in fact, some of the December 31st, which was supposed to be a power-packed service in our church, I set him to preach several times. And I saw the reactions in the deacons. But I never cared because that was the will of God. So it happens, but Jesus said to them, and this is the truth. So even though it comes to your head or comes to your mind as a human being, when you become a preacher, or when you become bigger, listen, this is the standard, this is the way to overcome it. He sat down and called the 12 and said unto them, if any man desire to be first, the same shall be last of all and servant of all. The ministry is all about service. And he took a child and set it in the midst of them. And when he had taken him in his hand, he said unto them, whosoever shall receive one of such children in my name, receive me. And whosoever shall receive me, receiveth him, but not him that sent me. Praise the name of God. Clap your hands and celebrate God. Anyone that stands here to preach, receive them in the name of the Lord. Even if they are slow of speech, receive them. They may not be as eloquent as I am, but God has sent them to preach to you. Praise the name of the Lord. And that's the way. I don't believe in one man kingdom ministry. Pastor is the only star. Praise the name of the Lord. Number what? Where are we? Number seven. The way to be crowned is through the cross. The cross is the midpoint between your will and God's will. His will crosses, cancel, and prevail over your life. I will read just one scripture to you. 2 Timothy chapter 4. The way to a joy to have a crown is to endure your cross. Each of us have a cross. So I have mine. I just bore a part of it this morning and I keep bearing it in life. Praise the name of the Lord. There are crosses all over our path in life. But if you are ever going to enjoy the crown ahead of you, please don't lay down your cross. Carry it with you everywhere you go. You've got a cross. I've got a cross. The teachings of Christ is this. Don't dodge your cross. If you dodge your cross, if you neglect your cross, if you ignore your cross, you are ignoring your crown. My comfort to you is this. There's a crown ahead. Hallelujah. Look at what Paul said. I love this last. He says, I charge it therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing in verse 1. Preach the word. Be instant in season and out of season. Rebuke. No matter how powerful and eloquent and gracious a preacher is, he doesn't last forever. One day we'll lay down his sword. Will he have a crown or will he not? He says, verse 3, for the time will come when they will not. And he says in verse 7, verse 6, let me go there. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. He's talking about his death. He said, I have fought. He said, I am now ready to be offered. How many of us know my tomorrow? You don't know my tomorrow? Oh, maybe I'm the only one. You know, one of his prayers before he died is this. And he preached about it. He said, I want to die empty. He said, I don't want to have something in me that I'm supposed to give to this generation that I didn't. And he died empty. Look at what he said, I'm ready to be offered and the time of my departure is at hand. He said, I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. I didn't lay down my cross. He said, because of this, henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto all them that love his appearing. Because that day I was supposed to fall into that temptation of fornication, I overcame. Because that day I was supposed to sleep with that woman that is not my wife, I overcame. There is a crown of righteousness waiting for me ahead because I bore my cross. My flesh didn't want me to have that cross. But I took on my cross. And because the way to be crowned is through the cross, Paul is enjoying in glory now. Finally, the way to gain is to lose. The way to gain is to lose. The very words of Jesus Christ. I can want to tell somebody here, you cannot be read if you don't read. And you cannot be celebrated if you don't celebrate others. Matthew chapter 16, verse 26, quickly. I thought the Lord wants me to read these scriptures. Well, let's read it and then we close. Matthew chapter 16, verse 26. Is it on the screen?
Yeah.
Let's read it together. For what is man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Philippians chapter 1, verse 21. Philippians chapter 1, verse 21. Grace be unto you. No, that's verse 2, 21. Oh, it's still. Is it there now?
No.
Philippians chapter 1, verse 21. We are so used to the screen. Our hand is even rusty. Doesn't want to open this one again. Philippians chapter 1, verse 21. Okay. Okay. Read it, church. For to me, to live is what? Christ. And to die is gain. This same Paul says, for I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Paradox. He said, not yet, not I, but Christ lives in me. He said, the life that I now live in the flesh, I live it by the grace of the Son of God who died for me. Hallelujah. Look at chapter 3, verse 7 of Philippians. Chapter 3, verse 7 of Philippians. He says, but the things which were gained to me, those I counted loss. Not because I'm stupid, but because of Christ. Hallelujah. And the way to what? To gain is to lose. You remember the story of the widow? The Shunammite, is it the woman, the widow? The Shunammite widow in 1 Kings chapter 17, verse 9. When Elijah, it wasn't Elisha this time around, it was Elijah. He was hungry in the wilderness and he went there. And then God said, go and meet that old widow. And he went there and the widow was preparing the last meal. And Elijah said, please, can you give me some water? I like Elijah because he started small. You notice that this woman was willing to give me water. She should be able to give me food according as God has spoken to me. So please, can you just make some bread for me as you're going? Mm-hmm. And the woman said, my Lord, the last bread in my house, I am preparing it for myself and for my son. And we were thinking that by the time we finish, that will be our last meal and we are preparing to die. I don't know who is preparing to die. And God is saying, lose something. Because that will be the beginning of your life. Hallelujah. And then the woman said, oh, we are preparing to die. He said, no. Just go and do what I said. Okay. He said, okay. And as he was going, Elisha saw the willingness and said, look, you are about to start living. Because the barrel of meal will not waste. And the cruse of oil will not dry. Until God said, rain.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Can anybody say the paradox of our faith? Somebody said something and I want to quickly read it for us. I just picked this one online and it aptly describes what we are talking about. Can we read it together? Even life itself, even time has paradox. Look at it. We live in times where we see many humans but not enough humanity. Is that not paradoxical? The second one. We live in times where the rich has more rooms than children. And the poor has more children than rooms. Paradox of our time. The rich will be living on an estate with 28 rooms. And yet, they only have one son or one daughter. Am I wrong? And you see people, family of eight, cramped in one room. Somewhere. We live in times where smartphones bring you closer to those who are far. It's coming to a time that when families gather together or when husband and wife are together, if there's anything we are fighting about in my home, this is one. How can families be together and somebody will be on phone alone and be laughing and be giggling? See, you are connecting with people in Nigeria, connecting with people in New York. But there's a distance now between you and your children. There's a distance now between husband and wife because of phones. We live in times where smartphones bring you closer to those who are far off, but distance you from those who are close. Go. We live in times where a single mother can look after 10 children, but 10 children cannot look after a single mother. We live in times where the rich walk miles to digest food, while the poor walk miles to obtain food. Paradox of life. We live in times where our contact lists are huge, but our relationships are poor. You see somebody, 4,000 followers on Facebook, and he died. 50 people showed up. Where are his followers? The social friendship is not the real friendship. Contact with people. When you are with people, lower your phone and talk. May God give me grace. May God give us grace.
Amen.
We are all guilty of these things. Let's go. We live in times where our possessions are more, but our contentment is less. You will soon realize, by the time you buy those 5 houses, that all is vanity. Hallelujah. By the time you finish building your house, you soon realize, all is vanity. Hallelujah. We live in times where we know how to earn a good living, but someone forget how to live a good life. As like somebody will work 30 hours in 48 hours. Go on. We live in times where many know the price of everything, but the value of nothing. Go on. We live in times when people get power but cannot empower others. Indeed, we live in a paradoxical world. May God help us all to see beyond the ordinary.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Rise up on your feet and surrender all to Jesus today. We have 5 minutes into the service. Unto Jesus I surrender, unto me I freely give. I will ever, Lord, and trust in
joy.
If I see 40 sheep who've gone astray, I am sure he will show me his glory. When I'm gone, I'll ask my Lord away. Yes, Lord. When I'm gone, I'll ask my Lord away. Oh, yes, Lord. I shall rest at the close of.
Share it with your contacts and don't forget to like and subscribe to this YouTube channel. Stay blessed.